Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in to Altium Academy, and guess what? We just hit 20K subscribers. I'm so happy about this. You guys have been great tuning in and watching these videos, and I know a lot of people are learning a lot from these videos. We've been getting so many of your questions and comments, and we've tried to hit them all in the comments section, but guess what? We wanted to do a special Q&A video just for your specific questions that you sent in to youtube@altium.com. Not altium at youtube.com. youtube@altium.com. You guys sent in tons of great questions. I got inundated with requests. I've tried to hit some of the best ones, so I've packed them all into one video, and I really hope you guys enjoy this. Benet from Switzerland writes, I've been thoroughly enjoying the video series by Zach Peterson and would like to ask a question regarding dividing separating grounds. I understand that when designing a mixed analog and digital PCB, it is wise to distance analog subcircuits from digital subcircuits. Does this also include separating / breaking the respective grounds from one another? I've heard mixed signal opinions and would appreciate any clarification. So I added in the little mixed signal opinions because this is important in mixed signal design. The important point here is that it is best to use a single uniform ground plane and to separate those digital and analog components over different areas of the ground plane as best you can. Technically, you can use two different ground planes. The problem is that the two portions of the design can't reliably interact with each other because you'd have to route over a gap between the ground plane, and that's what creates your big EMI problems. That's why it is best to just use a single uniform ground plane. Using the split planes, it enforces very bad routing habits that create more problems than they actually solve. And if you go back and you watch some of our earlier videos on mixed signal design, you'll actually see why it's a lot easier to just use a single uniform ground plane. Here's a hint, it relates to keeping track of your return paths. Fetty Mockney writes, thank you for these amazing series of videos. I would like to ask about when we need to put ground pour ear traces and when we don't do it. I see many designs where some put ground pour all over the PCBs and some designs just don't put any pour there. Ground pour offers some important advantages in very specific situations. So it's not just a situation that you should just go into your signal layer, select a polygon all over all four corners of your board, hit that pour button, and watch it all fill in with copper. It's actually a little more complex than that. I heard that when you put it, it works as a shield for crosstalk between traces. Also, it's much easier to construct the PCB with the ground pour rather than not, because the PCB manufacturer needs to remove it when producing, which is an extra set. What are the negative parts of it? It is true that if ground pour is properly constructed, it can be used as shielding against certain frequencies. It is not going to be the magic bullet for all frequencies and for every EMI problem, but if it is constructed properly, it could be used to provide some extra shielding in the design. Normally, ground pour, or I should say originally, ground pour was really meant for situations involving RF designs. So you need it when you have controlled impedance coplanar lines, you need it with coplanar waveguides, and you can use it for isolation in those situations where you're targeting a specific RF frequency. So if you look at some RF power amplifier PCB layouts, you'll actually see these rails that have a lot of via fencing in them. That's essentially what they're doing, is they're providing isolation between these different board sections. Now, they're also providing a very low impedance connection to a molded enclosure that can also provide additional shielding. So it's more going on than just fill in everywhere with your ground pour and then expect that your design is going to work properly. So just remember, if you think you need ground pour, what you should actually do is focus on the fundamentals first. Get your stack up design correct, route correctly, and if you do those two things correctly, you'll probably find that you don't actually need grounded copper pour all over every single signal layer in your PCB layout. Aaron Arcelas Ventus writes, I am in love with your YouTube videos. They are just great. So first of all, thank you for them. It would be very interesting to know more about signal integrity issues and especially how to simulate. I know Altium has a tool for doing that. You can upload IBIS models and simulate. So that is true. Altium does support IBIS models, and these are behavioral models for modeling signal integrity in different components and interconnects. It would be very helpful for designers like me to learn to use it correctly and to understand what's going on, how to include the real design of the PCB in the simulation with trace width and lengths and terminations, etc. So yes, there is a utility inside Altium Designer that lets you simulate reflections and crosstalk using some standard 2D field solver methods directly in the PCB layout. So the answer is yes, you can do that, assuming you know the logic family of the chip that is driving a signal into the interconnect. So you can do those simulations. Now, what Altium also lets you do is you can export a file that you can use in a more advanced simulation tool like ANSYS, and that will allow you to go much deeper with some of your simulations. But just as some of the basic bare bones evaluation that you might need to do with crosstalk and reflections, Altium does have a tool to simulate that. We'll be doing a video on this later that actually shows how to use that tool. Mosin Tusi writes, "Firstly, I appreciate you and Altium for creating such a helpful and priceless content on YouTube. As an electronics engineer, I still have doubts and issues with PCB stackups and layer orders. There's a lot of information on the web, and most of it is misleading and goes against each other. Could you please let me know what's the best approach to make decisions about the layer orders in 4, 6, and 8-layer PCBs?" Well, I'll do my best. So in some previous videos, we discussed 4-layer stackups and some of the alternatives of 4-layer stackups. 4-layer stackups are a good place to start learning about how to construct a stackup to meet certain design objectives. Now, there isn't gonna be one perfect stackup that hits everything. And sometimes when people tell you that you should do your, you know, 6-layer stackup in a specific way, they're probably talking about a very specific situation that isn't universal to all boards. First, you should start with considering, do you have to work with high frequency, high speed, high current? Because that's gonna determine how many plane layers you need and where to put them. After doing that, you need to think about the number of signal layers you might need. As you need more signal layers, you may need to also add in plane layers to support that. So that's what takes you from a 4-layer board to a 6-layer board, and then an 8-layer board, and so on and so forth. So that's the best I can do at this point, but we'll actually look at in a future video about 6-layer and 8-layer PCBs and even higher layer counts. So our super fan, Fetty Mockney, writes in again, "On a 4L board with a signal ground power signal stackup, if we want to route a signal from the top to the bottom layer, how exactly do we need to care about the return path?" So this is a bit of a long question, and we actually just did a video on this that looks at how you can look at the power plane as a return path, or as a reference plane in your design. The current can couple capacitively from a power plane back to a nearby ground plane. And in Fetty's question, one thing that he asks about is a bypass cap. And yes, a bypass cap can be used as a return path from a power plane back to the ground plane. This is actually kind of complex because you need to take advantage of the capacitive coupling through a capacitor in order to get from a power plane back down to a ground plane. Take a look at our other video, we'll post it in the description, and that should help answer some of these questions about how to think about your return path from a power plane back to a ground plane. Ali Najad writes, "As everyone knows, switching regulators make noise on a power rail. A simple way for filtering this noise is to put ferrite beads in series with the power rail. But as you mentioned several times, it increases PDN impedance. My question is, how can we get rid of this noise without increasing PDN impedance? Can we put that ferrite bead and add multiple decoupling capacitors after that, or can we just ignore that noise?" So, noise on a PDN comes in a couple of different forms. Here we're talking about switching regulator noise. Switching regulator noise does need to be shunted away or suppressed with inductance, which is why in a switching regulator, you do have an inductor on the output, and the size of that inductor will determine the ripple coming out of your regulator. You can also suppress that noise using a higher frequency PWM signal. That higher frequency is also going to suppress that switching regulator noise from reaching into the PDN. Now, one of the reasons that we don't want to use ferrite beads on a PDN is when we're dealing with high speed signals and high speed components that need to draw a lot of power from the PDN. So that's the instance where we really don't want to use a ferrite on the PDN. Using a ferrite on a PDN does increase the impedance, and the preferable way to reduce the noise from switching in high-speed signals is not to add impedance, it's to actually lower the impedance by using more capacitors. Don't confuse a switching regulator that is about to provide power to a DC component or a low-frequency component versus a PDN that needs to provide power to a high-speed component with a high number of IOs. The power situation in both of those types of systems is actually a bit different. If you have a regulator, you just need to send some DC voltage over to a component that's just running at DC, you know, throw that ferrite bead in there because it's performing its exact function to provide high impedance to high frequency noise that you don't want to reach your DC component. Andriy Setyanabrata writes, Hi there, I have some requests for YouTube Altium. Can you make some video about manual routing, like placement, the right router technique, and many more in one video?
Well, we'll do our best. So I'm working with some of the internal folks at Altium to make sure that we can get all of these requests answered. So stay tuned to the channel, hit the subscribe button, and yes, we will show some routing example videos that address these questions that you brought up.
We've got another one from Fetty Mockney. Fetty writes, hello, I would like to ask a question regarding the return current path. I know that it usually returns under the signal trace, but where does it stop? Under the pin of the ground of the component which transmit the signal? Also, does DC power have a return path?
Number one, DC signals do have a return path, it's just not tightly coupled to the trace. The reason is that a DC current follows the path of least resistance, which is actually just going to be a straight line back to the ground reference point for that source. So the answer to the other question, Fetty, is it depends. It does go back towards that ground pin if that ground pin is actually referenced to the same ground that your power is referenced to. This can be a bit complex. So what I'm going to do is in the description, there's actually a really good blog on Altium's site that actually explains some of this and how to track the return path between these different pins on an IC. So go check out that blog. Anybody else that's interested in tracking return paths to different pins on an IC should go read that blog as well.
Sixada writes, hi, I'm your YouTube fan from Thailand. Your videos are great so far, and these are my questions. Number one, if I had an octocoupler for isolation and protection between power circuits and a microcontroller circuits, in your mixed signal design video, you said ground must be uniform. What should I do?
This is a great question. So, in a system where you need to have isolation, the entire point of splitting a plane is to provide some type of galvanic isolation. So this is normally done in power systems, and you can use an optocoupler to bridge that gap while ensuring that you still have galvanic isolation. That's one of the primary purposes of optocouplers. So if you need that type of isolation, then that's why you would split power planes and ground planes in a mixed signal system.
If I design two-layer PCBs, I set the bottom layer as a ground plane and the top layer as signal plus power plane. Is this suitable for EMI protection?
It can be. You need to be careful with this just because you can have large loop inductance paths even if you do have that ground plane and your signals are sourcing high DIDT signals. Now, generally in that type of system, you're gonna go to at least four layer. So if you just have a two layer system and you throw a ground plane on it, chances are you'll be good as long as you're not running at super high speeds.
Third question from Sixada. In a ground plane, can I route a track?
You can route a track in a ground plane. That's totally fine. The problem is that now you're cutting up your ground plane and you could interrupt return currents that are trying to couple capacitively into the ground plane. So just be careful if you need to do that. If you really do need to have a second layer for signals, go to a four-layer board. It's really not that much more expensive than a two-layer board, especially if you might be going overseas to manufacture and get some prototypes created. It's going to be better for signal integrity, and it's going to be easier to route.
Fourth question. Some MOSFETs are in DPAK package. What is the best solution to connect from the component to the ground plane? The DPAK is attached on the top layer, and ground place is in a bottom layer.
I don't normally tell people to go to Wikipedia for PCB design advice, but if you actually look at Wikipedia, there is a decent image that shows how the pad on D2PAK or on a DPAK package actually connects to a ground pad. You just literally put a ground pad on the top layer and you can run a via that goes to your internal ground plane or whatever your ground reference is. That's the simplest way to do it. Last question, we're gonna go to Dmitry Shpekov.
Dmitry writes, good day. It would be great if you could explain about PCB surface finishes when using RF. Particularly if we have a PCB antenna, what surface finish should you use? Solder mask, enig, silver, hard gold, etc. And how this surface finish affects the PCB antenna parameters. As I know, we cannot use the same PC antenna geometrical parameters and matching circuitry for different surface finishes.
What you brought up is actually important in RF design. The surface finish can contribute some excess impedance due to its roughness. In addition, the solder mask has its own dielectric constant and its own loss tangent, which also affects the impedance of a printed element on the surface layer. Generally, with RF stuff, and especially the RF stuff that I've designed, pull off that solder mask on the RF component or on that RF printed circuit element, and then use immersion silver. Immersion silver is very low loss at high frequencies. And when I say low loss, what I mean is that it creates a very smooth interface with bare copper when that copper is plated during fabrication. So that's gonna be your best bet to reduce losses. The reason you need to pull off that solder mask, Well, number one, it has a dielectric constant of around 3 for LPI solder masks. The other reason is that the loss tangent can actually be like a factor 10 higher than the substrate. So let's say you're using a Rogers substrate, that loss tangent could be in the neighborhood of, you know, 0.002, but for the solder mask, the loss tangent will be about a factor 10 higher than that. So pull that solder mask off because it's going to introduce extra losses into your RF interconnect. All right, everybody, thank you so much. This is just one of many of these Q&A videos that we're going to do. I've got a huge stack of other questions that you guys have sent, and I'm so happy that you guys have responded so positively and sent in so many questions. So keep them rolling in. We're going to do another Q&A video as soon as we can, and hopefully this helps answer as many questions as you guys have. If you like this video, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button. Help us hack that YouTube algorithm, and definitely don't forget to call your fabricator.